Welcome to the Void. We're here. It's after midnight. It's the witching hour, because that's when we like to do things on the Void. We've got John here from Baroness. How are you this evening?
Pretty well.
How was the show? Did you enjoy yourself? Was it...
I always enjoy myself.
It's rubbish. I hated it.
Yeah. No, our tours in Australia are always fun.
I was listening to your record again on the way here, because I like to try and think about it like a cinematic thing. And I feel like... So I've got this like... This is not based on lyrics, it's just based on vibe. I'm like, initially it feels like a bunch of people kind of triumphantly going up through the earth's core, like some shit has happened where we're like now burrowed into the earth, and then you come through the earth and then you're on like a pirate ship and you're like triumphantly kind of going through this salty sea-ish kind of thing, and it's like hard, but like there's all these good waves that you catch. It's like everyone's vibing because they like escaped the earth's crust. And then you get to the island and like everyone gets sad for a minute because a bunch of people died. And so there's like this kind of moment of like reflection. And then everyone's like, but we lived. So let's like have a bunch of harmonies and sing. And then later everyone gets a bit sad again because everyone died. And then it's fine. So that was my take on the Purple record.
Yeah, I guess that's sort of what it sounds like. And no, honestly, like my thought on how records are laid out, especially ours, is... It's like this. You start here, you go up, you go down a little, you go up a little, you go down a lot, and then you come back up at the end.
Well, that's how it felt.
Yeah, that's a very shorthand version of all of our records.
Yeah. Well, but don't, you know, we have to summarize them real quick.
Yeah, if you read the lyrics, then it's not as much of this. It's kind of just the...
Well, what did it feel like for you? Like, how did this kind of... Did you want to make it cinematic and kind of... Because it is cinematic.
I want to make all of our records cinematic. Yeah. I mean, I don't, you know, for a very long time, I didn't really understand the idea of like a good time record. It just wasn't something that registered with me. I like kind of bummer music. You know, that's what I favor.
I like honestly. Bummer music.
Yeah, music that's got very little happiness or, you know, positivity to it.
And well, it can feel false at times. Tribe.
It can. I mean, but there's certainly people that love disco. Well, let's just call it that.
Not a disco guy.
No, disco.
You are a disco guy.
I've spread my wings a lot, you know, over the course of my life, and I understand that music now, and I'm a little bit more accepting, and I can vibe out on it. But you know, at the core, I always preferred kind of down music because I think that's. I don't know, if I'm going to be a little philosophical, I think that the language of music is most easily put out there and understood by, you know, a mass of people when it deals with difficult subjects, you know, the things...
Like sorrow.
Sorrow, yeah. Pain, frustration, angst, turmoil, because everybody knows that.
It's a universal experience.
Knows it. Yeah.
I think that's what's great about this album. I think there's this like joyous kind of violence about it. And that's what I mean. It's like being at the end of the world. Like everything's fucked and everyone's dead, but we're on this pirate ship and it's sick. Sure, and it's like there's like creaky boards and like, you know, we're going to start a new frontier.
The fortunate thing for me, because my tendency is just to go, you know, straight up depressing because, I don't know, that's where music comes from for me.
Yeah.
But I don't have a band full of people who feel that way. So
that's interesting. So who's Mr. Joyman?
I wouldn't say that it's like everybody's like Mr. Joyman, but the rest of, you know, the rest of the group, when, you know, when we were, especially when we were writing this record, didn't want to get stuck in some sort of depressive, you know, very melancholic, you know, sort of down tempo.
There's a James Hetfield yell in there. There's a few of them. I feel like the like primo Hetfield yell.
Yeah, I just that's
in a good way.
That's what happens when
I was good.
Out sometimes. Yeah. But you know, like they wanted to keep the energy. They wanted to keep the very high energy. They're, you know, because we've always been like, you know, a fairly high energy band, and so I think that the, you know, the more sort of celebratory the music sounded, the more sort of, you know, triumphant, and
that's why it's so great.
That the actual music was, and that the rhythms were, then it became a very interesting and open place for me to just be very straightforward, you know, with some of the things that I was going through, which, you know, none of which were particularly pleasant. And so I didn't have to you know, I never have, and I probably never will have the luxury of trying to like step into somebody else's shoes and write a song about a character who's, you know, going through something. You know, unfortunately, that's things have just been happening to me, and probably everybody else. But it seemed like an interesting juxtaposition where if the music's up tempo and it's got all this triumph and celebration, then I can get very direct and very focused and real with the things that I want,
like a purple vein through.
Yeah, the things that I wanted to talk about and the things that I couldn't help but talk about. So there's kind of an interesting blend on it. To me, it's very honest, and the music's very pure, and it's fun in a way. It's fun in the way that it can be fun to tell the truth.
It is fun to tell
the hard truth.
It's interesting you say that, because I kind of think about well, like when you talk to people who have like created a character, or it's a concept album, there's something a bit removed of that, about that, and it's something a bit almost egotistical in some ways, and a bit kind of stepping outside the quantum field sort of thing.
Look, anybody that willingly steps up on the stage and enjoys it is, you know, it takes a healthy ego.
Yeah.
But I think the interesting thing is that there's a way to do that with where you want to be on stage. You think you believe in yourself, that you have a message to transmit to an audience that's worth listening to, and that
well, then you're a conduit more than an ego. Like you're almost like a channel.
But the ego's still there.
Yeah, you're
just,
right.
It's just it's not that it's just that there's a line where. Some people think that their message is more important than other messages, whereas I tend to think that if you have a genuine message, if you're just speaking honestly, and your songs are good, then people will find you. Yeah. Like when we were punks, or when we were young, or when there wasn't a whole lot at stake, we did it for the love of the game. You know, like purely, it's about the infinite stream and history of music that we jump into and become part of for just
a
short little part of time, you know, and
that's cool, man.
Look, we were making music before we had a collective consciousness, before we before we could even explain to other cultures about our music. People were making rhythms, and they were
harmonies.
Humming songs before classical Western music was invented, And that
right here in Australia, like there's hundreds of thousands of history.
And why?
Years?
Because it's because there is a release, and there is an importance, not just personally but culturally and in a community, that people can get together and celebrate something in times of adversity.
You can really feel it in a great rock show we've raised the frequency on some.
It's just we've taken the idea of the human experience and really like refined it and found this one little line, but I think it's a very important one, and that is, you know, we as a species enjoy the communal experience.
We're not separate,
because instinctually, if we're together as a group, we're going to survive. But back to what I was saying a minute ago, I think like a very big moment for me that probably was catalyzed by the accident and everything that I went through, was that I learned in the moments where I thought potentially I will never be able to play music again. I may never be able to, use my limbs in a realistic way. In those moments, it became obvious to me that I really enjoy being on a stage and having this, having that kind of communication.
Yeah, like a new appreciation for it sort of thing.
Yeah, but also I can say I like being, like I can say that.
You're like a performer.
I like performing, and it doesn't, and it's not in a purely entertaining way. Like, I'm not trying to entertain people. I'm doing what I love doing. I'm doing what I would undoubtedly do otherwise. Yeah. I would do it.
Actually, quite the opposite.
I would do it regardless. Yeah. I'm just lucky. People, there are people who enjoy what we do.
You got nominated for a Grammy today. But, you know, just speaking of public approval, but I'm like, yeah, with Gojira and Periphery, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah, yeah. It's good company.
You know what I mean? Like, I was looking at it going, wow, that never happens here. Like, actual heavy metal bands in the heavy metal category. Like, obviously there's some, but they never win.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I mean, it's an odd thing because 15-year-old me would have been like, man, fuck that. Whatever. You know, like...
Pissing on the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Brains
are going to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. That's fucking weird. I mean, they're fucking awesome, but it's like, it's still weird.
Yeah.
But it's great.
They did. They set the temp. They and three other bands set the template for, you know, what we do.
Totally.
Same way that, you know, the Delta Blues set the tone for Zeppelin or something, you know?
Such a weird.
We take the ideas that we've seen in the past and we just use them. And of course, Bad Brains they were amazing musicians.
Fuck yeah.
They circumvented the norm in the community of punk. They were an abnormality.
Yeah, well, Duff McKagan was saying, I used to see HR and I was just like, wow, like what the fuck? This guy is just off his fucking tree in this awesome way.
He is off his tree, and you know, it is in an awesome way. And like, why wouldn't you want that? You know, why wouldn't you want to be?
Home bruised.
Why wouldn't you want to be an individual? And they're a fantastic example of a truly unique, truly individual band. And you know, there are moments in what they've done that I disagree with on a musical level, or you know, moments.
You can't win them all.
What he does that I'm like, well, that's
your jam, buddy.
That doesn't fly with me, but. You know, the impact that they had is undeniable. It's just a little, you know, it's not as easy, or it's not, Black Flag is like, yeah, it's easier to like Black Flag, right? You know, because you get the four bars and, you know, cool, okay, you're in the club. But, you know, I think it's probably been 4 or 5 years ago where I read something, I think it was Rollins who was saying that he was doing this experiment where he would just try to listen to a record he'd never heard every day.
That's cool.
Doing it for 5 years, though.
Really?
Yeah. And it
dude, that's so good. Awesome.
Everybody poo-poos the whole, you know, streaming services and the immediacy and the, you know, the, at least with Spotify, it, you know, it's a service. You're paying for something. But the wonderful thing is, the world's at your fingertips with it. So I ask anybody, from friends to strangers to, people I meet at shows, what do you listen to? They say something and I write it down and that's what I listen to tomorrow.
That's so good.
If I'm going to dislike something and I'm going to talk about how I dislike it, I want that to come from a place of understanding and at least some comprehension.
Like, I think The Weeknd was interesting and I've kind of seen that. I think he's kind of fascinating. Like, and I've been really studying it. Like, people are like, oh, it's pop music. I'm like, no, it's fucking interesting.
But on that note, what's wrong with pop music?
Exactly. And then 400 million people streamed it. I'm like, I'm sorry, it's fucking good.
Good pop music is good. Good pop music is what that's what we want, right?
Yeah.
Like, our problem as people who come, you know, who inhabit the underground, and we listen to really extreme stuff.
Yeah.
But that's because we're dissatisfied with what's happening in popular culture or in pop music.
It's so bland.
We should be thrilled when there's a good pop album. What about those Will Smith? Like, he put out that one song every summer.
Boom, Shake the Room.
Yeah, and they were like, they were super innocent.
Eddie Murphy, Party All the Time.
That's a ridiculous song.
It's got Rick James in it.
Yeah. I know this is what everybody's saying right now, but it's because it's true. But the Tribe Called Quest album is pretty incredible. Pete, our guitar player, was like, dude, you got to listen to the Tribe record.
It's so good.
Yeah, no, it's great. And then, you know, I've been doing a lot of, like, fly-in dates recently, and I was watching Silicon Valley on...
I love that show.
Yeah, I like the show, too, but the end credits always have some amazing song in them because the music for that is awesome. And I heard that DJ Shadow Run the Jewels collaboration, and I was like, oh, damn, that is so good.
I got Introducing the day that I got dumped and I bought Introducing Everything But the Girl and Fiona Apple.
I'm not gonna spill the beans right now, but if I had to like really explain where most, you know, there's like maybe 10 records that I always go back to if I'm needing an idea.
What about one? one on the list.
Private Press is one. Yeah. Because it has nothing.
So it has interesting.
It has nothing to do with Baroness, and it has it's barely. There's barely any points of connectivity between that record and what we do, but there's so many ideas there that I've been able to co-opt.
It's about like a creative expression sort of thing, and like I was looking at the drawing, trying to draw the Electric Ladyland cover, and I'm like, there's actually something kind of interesting about your covers and Electric Ladyland in that they're almost like in another planet, like, you know, because that was like all these interesting different women.
It's awesome.
There's actually kind of some sort of a thread, you know, like just a lot of really different women. And
what I do, it's so painful. It's so finicky, and it's so based in my like obsessiveness. And I just kind of took my hands off the wheel when I was young, way too young, and just whatever works for me, I'm gonna do it. And you know,
does it kind of come through your hand, or do you find it harder? Like
No. I've
gotten back into drawing, and I feel like I'm just like some person with a stick while you're over there in like an art gallery and shit.
One, if you're driven to create and make things, like who cares what it looks like, right? There are certain highly celebrated artists or people whose work that I see who have become so good at the craft of what they're doing that I'm absolutely disinterested in it. And I'd much rather watch children make art, because it's 100% express it.
Well, it's like mechanical, yeah.
Well, I mean, in music and in art, I've always made a very hard distinction between, you know, in art, I think you're either an artist or you're a designer. Okay? And designers
do it for money?
There's more money. There's more money in design than there is in art. But you know, to be a designer, your role is predicated on the fact that you're very good at the technique and the craft of what you're doing.
And so, meaning a brief.
Yeah. So it's craftsmanship, and art can use that, but it doesn't require it. You know.
Yeah.
In order to make something resonant and, you know, something with an emotional core, it doesn't need to be well executed.
Perfect.
Yeah, it doesn't. No.
David Bowie.
Imperfections are what define artists, because it's those eccentricities that our hands have. In drawing and painting and stuff like that, art's a much bigger world than that. But, you know, in terms of making a picture, you know, I think it's far more important that there's something in there that shows who you are than, you know, than in.
That's cool. Do you have people on pedestals and idols and, yeah?
Absolutely. Yeah. Doesn't
everybody? Who are your pedestal people?
Let me back up a little bit, but I think music's exactly the same, and this is why I don't really distinguish between the art that I make and the music that I make. But there are musicians who are great technicians, and they're great craftsmen, but there's very little feel to them.
Dude, you know what I mean? That's actually quite illuminating. There's a total match there, and I agree. I mean, it's a band
being technically proficient doesn't necessarily make you a great player. If you are a great soulful player and you have great technique, then that's just a double whammy. But you know, what is the magic of the Clash or the Ramones? It's not how many notes they play.
It's their humanity.
But then, you know, then there's the Hendrix type characters, and he's a paintbrush, you know.
Like a big paintbrush.
Yeah, I mean, there are moments where, you know, when you listen to Hendrix, you're like, I'm not sure he knows what he's doing here. But he naturally just makes that work, and then he has technique. But my guitar idols are pretty loose players. Yeah.
Who's your favorite?
I don't know that I have a favorite. I mean, in sort of modern guitar players, like, I think, you know, John Frusciante is incredible.
So good.
I think Johnny Greenwood is.
Johnny, that's. He's I had a boyfriend when I was 19 who was equally obsessed with John Frusciante and Frank Zappa. Equally obsessed, kind of a bit mental about it. But I'd never really thought about John Frusciante as that kind of a... Because it's really interesting. He like follows Hillel, and Hillel was his own kind of player, but then he took it to a whole other world.
Frusciante is... he's just an open heart, you know? I mean, it's just like, it's all... What you should do is watch. There are videos that exist online where when the Chili Peppers would tour and he was in the band, they would give him a song every night, and they'd stop playing.
You know your eyes in the morning time. I feel you touch me in the pouring rain. And the moment that you wander far from me, I wanna feel you in my arms again. And you come to me on the summer breeze, keep me warm in your love, then you softly. And it's me you need to show how deep in your love.
And then you like when watching this, I'm like, oh, this guy is the magic.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a magical player.
Yeah, no, totally.
And you can try and try and try, but you can't get that. You can't be that.
Sugar is still like one of the greatest albums ever. Like, yeah.
Especially if you isolate what he does on it.
Yeah. What's your favorite song on it?
This
is so random.
Should Have Lied.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, for Sinead O'Connor.
Is
no, he wrote that for Sinead O'Connor, and she totally dissed him. Anthony Kiedis. Okay, yeah, so Sinead O'Connor totally dissed him. He was like in love with this beautiful bald woman. Mm-hmm. And he went round to John's house, and he's like, I'm really fucking pissed off. Uh-huh. Sinead totally dumped me. And so he wrote that music that night. That's an example of John Frusciante being magical.
Yeah, and if you listen to his backups, they like kind of make the record. And I didn't, you know, when I was young, I didn't really understand how difficult it is to be that strong, like a backup singer. But the rhythm or the backup vocals in Breaking the Girl and in Under the Bridge, I thought it was women for a while.
You guys do really interesting harmonies. Like harmonies are a big part of what you do, and yeah.
I mean, I've always been real big on melody and harmony. I'm not sure why, because I'm not a trained player. I've just been doing it for a long, long time. But we were sort of talking about this recently, like, because there's some very particular things that I tend to do, you know, that I have some tendencies. And we were just kind of talking about it one day, and I think it's because my mother, when I was young, took me to see so many musicals, and that's all she listened to. And in truth, I don't think like it was like it was. This was what my mom was listening to. And so I listened to it, and I absorbed it in a way that wasn't
conscious
because I didn't.
You're a kid.
Because I was a kid, and I wasn't making a distinction on whether it was good or bad music. Yeah. This was just what I was listening to.
Like Matt Pike listened to Mahavishnu Orchestra and stuff when he was a kid because he had like hippie parents and that. He's like, I kind of absorbed it as a child.
So I didn't really realize, but this like kind of baroque, grandiose melody harmony thing.
You can totally hear that.
Yeah, it's kind of weird. I don't know that it's a good thing that I know that now, though. But that is a thing.
It's fucking interesting. Yeah. You know, I was thinking about it today. Like, what would you be doing if it hadn't like fucking fallen really hard for music?
I had pretty good SAT scores when I was.
Yeah, me too.
Probably would have done something.
With and then I was like
security, and you know, I think my parents saw that it at a very early age. Like, I'm stubbornly committed to it. Like, I will gladly incur bodily harm, mental harm, spiritual harm, because I devote myself to this. And
it's funny, isn't it? Do you seek light?
I think I do look for like the glimmers, because you know, there's sort of this perverse thing where, you know, when with a lot of people who are from what I understand, do have a little background. I've talked to a lot of people about this, and researched or read up on a little bit. But you know, people who are creatively driven, you know, they tend to have a harder time. You know, socially, they tend to have a harder time. You know, mentally, they're like
awkward children.
We struggle a little bit, you know, because
it's a way of coping, and the way of coping is kind of connecting you to the bigger picture? Like, you draw every day?
Yeah.
Like, all the time? Wait, you do other shit.
I am essentially taking a break from drawing right now because we're talking.
That's cool.
That's all I do.
Yesterday, and do you complete things or do you just kind of fuck around and then? Yeah.
Whatever. I mean, I've been doing
that's
it.
A
I've been doing
this question.
I got to the point a year or two ago where I felt that both musically and artistically that I had become fairly good at what I was doing, the specific things that I was doing, and that I couldn't really push that any further without, you know, making some drastic change to my routine. So I started writing music a little differently. I started writing songs a little differently, but you know, artistically, I felt like I had become very precious with things because I mean, listen to our music. Look at my art. It's very much about.
It's not an accident.
Details and like repetitive things, and it's very complex. And like I think I really fear space. Because I just feel it.
It's all fucking dense. Yeah, actually, if you really look at your back catalog, there isn't much space.
It's really dense.
The moments that are spacious in that record really are really notable.
Purple, that's I realize like.
Yeah, actually, that's a really
space.
Good point.
Space gives, you know, this is a pretty simple musical concept that a lot of people naturally do, and people who study music know it, you know, in a different way. I didn't really study it, and I didn't really realize it until recently, but. Yeah. When you leave that space and then all of a sudden do the hyper full dense thing, that density becomes more potent, as does the space become more intimate. You know, and like I really sought something intimate with the last record.
It feels like that.
And then, you know, then I applied it to my art as well. I thought, well, you know, I make these big, ridiculously time-consuming pieces that end up as album covers, and I enjoy doing it. I don't even, you know, at a certain point, like they're not even album covers for me. They're just parts of a big series of things that I'm doing, and I hope the bands that I'm working with, I hope that's not an insult to them because I take everything that I do very seriously.
Well, it comes out of your head.
Yeah. My insistence on being very precious with things, and I get, you know, really finicky about it, and I don't really believe in that preciousness, you know. In my heart, I don't. So recently, I've been doing things that I consider very non-precious, and but it's just like spend 8 hours, cut yourself
and it's
off,
done.
And it's done. And then I'm doing this series right now.
Like one bar.
Yeah, no worries.
So
These are things that I do because.
That's amazing.
They're just, I'm using tools that I hate. Yeah. I'm doing a series of, I'm going to stop when I hit 200.
Wow.
It says, I don't know which one
okay,
this is.
Maybe, can you hold one up to
yeah,
them?
I mean, they're just, I mean, they're mostly portraits. It's just things
that
I, yeah.
Sick.
I mean, it's just exercises
cool.
In lines.
Do you feel like do they ever feel like people you know? Yeah.
Part of what I'm doing is trying to, you know, I'm trying to figure out how to use these like technical pens, which have no baked in expressiveness. I'm trying to use them in a way that I would use paint. Okay.
That's so sick.
And these ones aren't really finished, but.
I'm totally gonna take the camera off and get some shots.
And then
that's
yeah,
cool.
I started that one this morning. I try to do one a day. I mean, but. It's,
listening
it's,
to one record a day and one drawing a day.
Yeah, it's sort of irrelevant what the picture is. I'm
that's
trying to figure
sick.
Out something new with lines. At some point, I'll get tired of these exercises and I'll move on to something else. For right now, I'm using this.
But that's your obsession.
I'm using these pens. They're called microns. You know, like illustrators and architects really love them. I absolutely hate them. So I'm going to do 200 drawings with them because I'm going to learn how to like them and learn how to use them in a way that feels
cool.
Okay to me.
Yeah.
And then I'll switch to something else because I don't make breakthroughs unless I am doing something that I don't, I don't understand. And I think,
I want to get
work.
Yeah.
I haven't done any commercials. I haven't done any projects for pay this year.
Wow. Does it feel good?
it feels good, but I'm also I've also spent a year doing things that have no like intent. You know what I mean?
That's kind of cool, though.
It's got
kind of magic.
It's gotten me motivated in a different way, and it's allowed me to feel okay again because, you know, doing all the album covers, it's been very fun,
yeah.
And you know, part of the process with the album covers, I do a whole lot of studying. It's all based in, you know, it's all based in mythologies and, you know, oral traditions and written texts, and it has very much to do with, you know, the teachings of Carl Jung, like the idea of archetypes.
Synchronicity.
It doesn't matter, you know. Sure, there's a lot of women on the covers, and there's a lot of plants and animals.
Yeah, but women are so fun to draw.
But they are, you know, for me, yeah. You know, making figurative artwork in 2016 isn't, it's not on trend, as they say. So, it's like that, these images and this like sort of short language that I use is just, it's just a vehicle to work things out up here, because this doesn't make any sense to me anymore. I mean, I can't really think internally anymore. I think I've lost the capability to do it. So I would talk a lot. I'm a nervous talker.
Yeah.
Sure. So that's good. That's how I figure out how I'm feeling, because I say it. I don't
See,
really.
I feel like this is like talking is an ancient art that I think an entire generation doesn't get to do. And it's like I in part do this because I think deep conversation is what makes us human in some ways, same way making art, and like that's like we've been doing it forever.
I think that when you've done this, I mean, you don't really have to have done it very long, but I think you immediately, you know, if you're making art, if you consider what you do art, that may be enough to justify calling what it is art, you know? Like,
yeah.
if you consider it art, then it's art in a way.
It's fun.
Then for me, the requirement is that I have to ask why. What is the purpose of this?
What's the purpose of Baroness? Let's close on a deep note.
I mean, I can only preface this by saying, yeah. I'm only speaking for myself here because it is different to different people who are in it, but it has always been the outlet that I have, and the platform that exists for me to express myself in a way that I am unable to verbally. I'm unable to in, you know, the real world, where I have a very hard time. I feel comfortable use, you know, in the context of the band, talking about feelings and, you know, experiences and trying to make sense of what is happening, not just to me, but, you know, the way that I interact with the world. And, you know, so for me, philosophically, it's kind of a big thing. And it may be like very highfalutin sounding or, you know, ideologically dense. Because it's you know, they're rock songs and, you know, and pictures of things that we recognize. But I do want to know why I do it, you know, and I haven't answered that. I won't answer that, but I will continue to ask. And it is the process of creating that is energizing to me. It's not the finished product. That's unimportant. It's kind of uninteresting to me at a certain point. But
the process
is incredibly poignant to me. I do it for the process, you know. And
that's not always the case.
Yeah, I know. But
if you don't love the process, what the fuck are you doing with your life? You
right. But look, some people don't have the luxury of
enjoying themselves.
You know that. You know for. People aren't in different situations, have to do different things to get through the day, okay? And I do need this to get through the day, you know? Without it, things become very difficult for me. So in the periods where I'm, you know, there's inactivity is either thrust upon me or just the reality, I sort of fall apart because I've invested so much in this. This is, you know, it's so much a part of me. I just have to be careful that it's part of me and not the entire definition, but the more I do it, the more it really, you know, Baroness, the art that I make, the music, you know, that we make, it's more than a job. It's more than, you know, something fun. I mean, it is both of those things, but it's also
necessary.
It's necessary, and it's you know, in good and bad ways, it's really like me explaining how I think of myself or how I digest the world. Yeah, through a channel that everybody has access to, which is a little dangerous, you know. But
they don't understand it.
They don't
speak the language necessarily, or they think they speak.
Well, I was intentionally obtuse for a very long time because of that, and now, you know, in recent years,
it's like fuck it.
Yeah, in recent years, like. Well,
the fearlessness of life, as you get older, I think you get more fearless, you give less fucks, you kind of go, well, this is what I do, and I might as well enjoy it, and I might as well believe in myself, because really, anything else, like, why not?
I mean, the worst thing that can happen is I do something that's slightly embarrassing, but I'd rather be embarrassed, I'd rather suffer some minor embarrassment, which doesn't honestly happen that often, I don't really get, you know. Then suffer for the rest of my life thinking that I had the opportunity to do something or that there was something that I felt inclined to do and didn't
always
see it through.
Risk taking is important.
I've taken enough risks. Yeah.
On that note, thank you. This was The Voids, Baroness.